everyone. Welcome to Gospel Life Church. How are we doing this morning? How are we doing this morning? Are we ready to worship the Lord together this morning? We're going to sing a song that is called Jehovah, and this song, it calls us to call on Him. Amen? So we're going to call on His name. Jehovah just means Lord, and there are many other names of the Lord that we will call on Him and name Him. And there is power when we call on the name of the Lord. So let's stand and let's sing this song together. Amen? Amen. He is a provider. He is a healer. He is worthy of all that we have this morning. Let's sing this out. He shames every idol. He reigns without rival. He goes by the name of Jehovah.
Sing it out. Call the name. Come on.
His name. We sing of His amazing grace.
This is a failing.
took a moment to turn to somebody in front of you, behind you, maybe a new face, and say, good morning, happy Sunday.
Well, good morning, church family. How we doing? All right. It is good to see you all here on the Lord's Day and excited to be back in church. The Lord is good. If you are new with us, we would love to say hello. Right after service in our atrium there is a Take 5 table, we call it. Stop by, share your name, tell us how you got here, right here. Oh, some cool faces in the house today. I'm excited. Tell us who you are, and we would love to say the same about ourselves. Do that right after service. It is good to be back kind of in the fall swing. Yesterday, I tried to watch as much football as my eyes can see. Football is back, right? Right? And so that's all cool to celebrate. But actually, we celebrate that fall ministries are now kicking off. And so now we are here as Labor Day is upon us. We hope you enjoy that. But also, we are in full swing with our fall ministry. So small groups are beginning to start up. And so we've been talking about Rooted for several weeks now. Rooted is now a 10-week discipleship course that we are walking through within the context of small group. And then that's going to become our preaching series as well. And so super exciting. Our small group leaders met here this week getting trained up and ready. And so if you are not a part of a small group, it is really, really life-giving. There are small groups that will fit your needs, your schedule, your family size as well. And so check into that. You can scan a QR code or you can go directly to our website, gospellife.com, click on registrations, and sign up for that. We're going to be learning a lot. The seven rhythms, or what we call spiritual disciplines. And it's going to be a great deep dive for us this fall. And we want you guys to be a part of that. And also with fall ministry, Awana kicks back up September the 11th, right? September the 11th. Thank you, many faces in this room, as we have first service as well, that volunteer your time and your efforts to training students to grow and love the scriptures and to love the Lord and be in a community that's conducive to their growth. And so we've been having this going on for years. Mr. Josh has been our commander here front row. And so if that is something you want to participate in, maybe you're saying, hey, this fall, Tay, I want to give my time to something meaningful and impactful. Wednesday nights, you can do that. See Mr. Josh of the Next Steps on that. But also, too, be in prayer of the good work that is happening as a couple hundred students participate in our Awana weekly. And we are grateful for that over at our North Wheaton campus. We cannot do ministry and things like that without the tithe and offering, without your prayers, without your support of what the Lord is doing. And I realize every week we say that, and we mean it every week, because the ministry that we can partake of, do over the summer, over the fall, over the winter months. Our team is already prepping for Christmas, and we're trying to go out with a bang. I mean, Jesus is a big deal to us, right? Amen. Amen. So all those things happen because of your generosity of time, talent, and treasure. And for that, I am grateful. And so I want to pray for our day, pray for our offering, pray for the remainder of the service, and then we'll move to our worship step through communion. Join me in prayer. Lord, thank you for the privilege it is to worship together as God's people, to join together in this place, to honor you with our lips, with our energy as brothers and sisters in one faith. Lord, we do not take it for granted. It is an absolute privilege that we can put on our clothes, get in our cars, to drive into a church building with doors open, to come and proclaim and adore the name of Jesus as we just did through song. And Lord, we get to do that freely, realizing, Lord, that there are places around the globe where people cannot. And so, Lord, we come here today with deep anticipation to what you are going to do. Would you speak to us today? Will our hearts be encouraged? And may we leave fired up to do the mission of God as the people of God. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, every first Sunday, we get a chance to observe this holy table of communion. A very staple in the very faith of who we are as Christians. This was instituted years ago in the moment called the Passover, where God's people would get together and have this meal as a family, and it would signify their love for their Savior. And at that point, they would now take an animal or lamb and and have to kill it and put it on the doorpost of the home. So that way, when the angel came by, it would pass their home knowing that that person or that family was a part of the faith. Well, friends, we no longer have to figure out how we're going to atone, that's the word, for our sins, or how we're going to have to make this payment for the penalty and the punishment, because Jesus perfectly completed that. Sinless was he. Spotless Savior was he to come and satisfy the absolute wrath of God. And so no longer do we have to take that blood and do it on the doorposts of our homes. We now take that blood through saving relationship with Jesus Christ, and it's on the doorposts of our hearts, that our lives are now to be walking with him, and we realize what he has done for us in sealing our freedom and taking away the curse of sin through his death, burial, and resurrection. And the joy it is when we realize how sweet and how marvelous it is that we have that joy in Jesus Christ. I was reading this week, I was doing some studying with a person, and I went to Hebrews chapter 7 and began to talk about kind of the order of Melchizedek, kind of this great priest that we've seen traced throughout all of Scripture. And in Hebrews chapter 7, before I read 1 Corinthians, it compares Jesus to this earthly priest, and how Jesus is absolutely better compared to the order of Melchizedek being much more greater. And this phrase just jumped off the page to me in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 23 says this: this Jesus makes Jesus the guarantor of a better covenant. The former priests, who were many in number, because they were prevented by death from continuing in office, meaning they were human, they died, they could no longer serve as a priest, but he holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able to save the uttermost, those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. What a beautiful, beautiful picture of where our final priest, being Jesus Christ, now intercedes for us, and he saved us, called all of us by names, changed our identity, and gave us absolute freedom. And then we see this institute of Holy Communion in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, also there in Matthew. And it reads this: for I received from the Lord what I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he also took the cup after supper. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Not a blood, not the blood, not some animal blood, but in my blood, the final penalty and payment to satisfy God's wrath. He said, do this in remembrance of me. And so today, as we get ready to take these elements, it is a beautiful picture of sealing our freedom and our victory we have in Jesus Christ, calling us out of darkness, placing us into marvelous light. He is our everlasting hope and our joy. What's going to happen soon, I'm going to pray, and I'm going to ask you all to stand. You're going to exit from the center aisles in the back. You're going to grab the elements and hold them until we partake of them together. All the bread in the tray is gluten-free. I'm going to ask those who are serving, come and help prepare the elements. And then let us pray and get ready to receive them. Join me in prayer. Lord, thank you for the absolute joy of remembering who we are in Jesus. No longer are we slaves to sin, but we are free. No longer do we have to try to figure out how we will come back to God, because you've already had that plan figured out. And that was through the absolute perfect work of Jesus Christ. That he would forgive us, that he would call us sons and daughters of God. And then to ascend back to heaven and sit at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us to this day. For that, Lord, we are grateful. We pause as we hold these two powerful elements, the bread being the body and the cup being the blood. The great remembrance and sacrifice it took upon our Savior, his body to be beaten and bruised, crown of thorns upon his head, and then to be hung and speared in the side, and then to be lifeless, to come down upon a cross, to go into a grave, and yet on the third day, as promised in the word, he got up victoriously, defeating death and conquering the curse of sin, that we, for those who believe, as Hebrews says, even to the uttermost, our sins that was one, our sins that was many, give us freedom. And so, Lord, on the other side of remembering, we celebrate that now we are in this family and we partake of this meal together, declaring your death, burial, and resurrection until you come again. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to ask you now to stand. Would you start from the back aisles, come down the middle, two sides, grab your elements and hold them until we are ready.
Shall ever be. How marvelous.
as you hold these two elements in your hand, that song should strike up this joy, this happiness, jubilee inside of us to what Jesus has done for us, in us, that we might live for him. At this moment, I'm going to pray for the elements, and then we will take them together. Lord, how unworthy are we for the greatest gift a man, woman, boy, or girl could ever receive. And that is the acceptance of what Christ, our Savior, has done for us. For that, we cry hallelujah. For that, we tell you of our thankfulness and our joy of our salvation. And so today, we pause with this moment of worship to partake as God's people, to proclaim his death, burial, and resurrection until he comes. I pray the chew, the sip, and the swallow is forever a tasteful reminder of who we are now in Christ Jesus. Lord, we take this time as well to admit our sins to you, sins that we know, sins that we don't, that you have created us a clean heart and renewing us a right spirit. We thank you for the victory we have and the truth of the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen. As it says in the scripture, do this in remembrance of him. Let us eat together. Do this in remembrance of him. Let us drink together. The Lord is good and is absolutely worthy to be praised. Excited for this. Everything we've done today has led up to this moment. We just don't come the first Sundays and throw this in there as the Christian thing to do. This is an absolute staple of who we are as followers of Jesus Christ. Well, before I take my seat, I want to introduce our speaker for the day. I get a chance to be off today, which this weekend was great to just be at home and chill. Our speaker today, his name is Shane Dickinson. I've known Shane now for 12 years and counting. Shane was my roommate in college at old Moody Bible Institute. And so he knows every story about me and my life and my recklessness. And to this day, he is known in our home as Uncle Shane. He is a dear brother from another mother and father. His father's here. Thanks for coming over, Bob. Appreciate that. And I appreciate this guy. When I came to Chicago and we got matched up, it's like, Lord, all right, this is what you want. We're going to make the best of it. And we have for all these years. And so I love him. Appreciate you, man. Thanks for being here with us. And so Gospel Life, let's make sure he feels at home when he comes to share the word.
Amen. Well, let's stand as we respond and proclaim our belief in Jesus this morning. Steady, God, that is what we proclaim this morning, that we believe in you. We believe that you'll do what you said you do, God, that you will fulfill every promise that you've made to us. We thank you, Lord, that you have been faithful time and time again, that you have been provider and healer. Lord, and we call that out this morning. We call on your name, Jehovah, Lord of Lords and King of Kings, that you might be glorified in this place, God. Would you go before us now, Lord? Would you turn us back to yourself, Lord? Would you create a posture in our hearts of worship to you, that we would surrender all we have and all we know how to the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, to Jesus who came in flesh and died on our behalf that we might have life. We thank you, God, for communion and the moment that we've had this morning to remember that. And we ask, God, that you would be glorified. We thank you. In the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may be seated, and the kids are dismissed.
Thank you. All right, good morning, Gospel Life. As Tavon said, my name is Shane. I just want to say at the onset, I'm sorry, I go back and forth between Tavon and Tay. I was, between services, someone came up to me and said, I've never heard him called Tavon in my life. I was introduced to him as Tavon. I go, you know, back, Tavon, Tay, Taco King Tay, maybe even, you know, we go way back. But I just want to say at the onset how much your pastor means to me. As he said, we've known each other now for more than 12 years. You're one of, if not the dearest brothers I have in my life, and just the way that you've gone faithfully serving the Lord, and just you've been with me through unbelievable highs and some real lows. And so thank you, and I love you. All right. Crying at the onset. We're in trouble, folks. All right. Open your Bibles with me, if you would, to Numbers chapter 20. And forgive me, because I know sometimes Numbers takes a little bit of time to find. We don't go there often. I want to take every moment I have to make sure I'm working on this golf swing. I don't know if you know, tomorrow, Labor Day, real big day for golf. Real, real busy. I was talking to Tavon between services, hoping to find a tee time. Been unsuccessful so far. So if any of you are going golfing tomorrow and you got room for a third, maybe a fourth, let us know. But I love this game, and I don't know why I love this game. Because if you play this game, you understand exactly what I just said. There's so many things you have to remember. Keep your head down. Get your feet nice shoulder width apart. You want to swing nice back and through. Okay, head down, feet shoulder width apart. Swing nice and through. Now, I said I love this game, and I don't know why I love this game, and that's because I'm terrible at golf. Again, when you've known someone as long as Tavon's known me, and you've known someone as long as my father, who's also here, has known me, these two can attest I'm really bad at golf. And probably the chief reason I'm so bad at golf is that first idea of not keeping my head down. I don't know what it is. I get behind the white ball. I'm so excited. And all of a sudden, I find myself at Wrigley Field like I'm Sammy Sosa back in the home run chase. And I just go, and my head goes flying and the ball stays right there. And despite this, I know what I'm supposed to do. I know what I'm supposed to do. I mean, I'm supposed to keep my head down. I know what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to keep my feet shoulder width apart. I know what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to go nice and easy. But I fall into bad habits over and over and over again. Maybe you're like me this morning and you're a golfer and you know exactly what I'm talking about. But even if you don't play golf, I'd be willing to wager that there are things like it in your life that you know what you're supposed to do, but you fall into bad habits and often find yourself unable to do that which you're supposed to do. It might be in your job. It might be in raising your children. You might look at your children and say, because you see this in them as well, where here's an instruction, the way that I wish you would follow and go, and for some reason we fall into bad habits. Take heart, church. We are not alone. In fact, the Bible is filled in the Old Testament with story after story after story of a nation who has our same problem. See, the Bible does a fantastic job of chronicling the life and especially the mistakes of the nation of Israel. Like my golf swing, like that thing that you may identify in your life, the Israelites find themselves in this cycle. They're in a difficult situation. And God comes to miraculously save them, remove them, push them forward, or provide for them. For a season, they enjoy it and say thank you, but before long, they find themselves back in a position of complaining and confusion. They find themselves stuck in bad habits. It's like the great theologian and 11-time World Series champion, Yankees catcher Yogi Berra once said, it's like deja vu all over again, time and time. So this morning, we're going to take a look at a deja vu all over again moment in the life and history of the nation of Israel. And it's from this time, in this place, in this snapshot that we're going to get, that I hope we can gain a perspective that it's not just the nation of Israel that finds themselves in this deja vu situation, but you and I do as well. So we'll be there in Numbers 20, verses 1 through 13. And if you are somebody who likes to take notes, our big idea, we're going to get out in front of it here in the beginning, our big idea is that God always provides. Let me say again, God always provides. Now, if you're in the room this morning, a room this size, there's bound to be some people who say, amen, absolutely, God always provides, I've seen it, I know it, I believe it. But I'm also willing to wager that in a room this size full of this many people, that there are those of us who are here this morning who have a hard time with this statement. Because when we look in our lives, we see want and need. We see lacking. We have confusion. We don't know what to do, what to think, or what to say. Perhaps it's a transition in a job, a relationship's been uprooted, or you really just don't know where to turn. And so my hope this morning with the time we have together is that by the end of our time in Numbers 20 that we can say as one church united, and not just say, but mean, believe, and live, that God always provides. We're going to see this across three short scenes in our text this morning. Let's start in our first scene, Numbers 20, verses 1 through 5, which reads this way. And the people of Israel, the whole congregation, came into the wilderness of Zin in the first month. And the people stayed in Kadesh. And Miriam died there and was buried. Now there was no water for the congregation. And they assembled themselves together against Moses and against Aaron. And the people quarreled with Moses and said, "Would that we had perished when our brothers perished before the Lord. Why have you brought the assembly of the Lord into this wilderness, that we should die here? Both we and our cattle. And why have you made us come up out of Egypt to bring us to this evil place? It is no place for grain or figs or vines or pomegranate, and there is no water to drink." Our first scene we're going to label this morning is the community grumbles. The community grumbles. Our text opens by stating that the people of God have found themselves here in the community of Kadesh. And I think it's important when we read the Word of God, especially here in the midst of Israel's story, that we understand this is not some sort of fairy tale, princess and the pea type moment where once upon a time the nation of Israel happened to find themselves in Kadesh. What happens next? No, instead we need to realize that we're jumping in the middle of a group of people, a nation that has been wandering for almost 40 years. They've legitimately been in the desert, walking place to place, morning, afternoon, evening, day after day, month after year after decade, walking around to see where the Lord is taking them. And having traveled for a long period of time, the nation of Israel's gotten really good at identifying if they have what they need or they don't. And so when they come to this new area, it doesn't take long for the people to look around and say, "Hey, there's no water to drink. There's no water for me, for my livestock, for our family. This isn't good." And I think in this moment we can say, you got a point, Israel. That makes sense. This is a really large group of people who's traveling a far distance, who has livestock and people who are thirsty, and they need something to drink. Now, I don't know about you, but when I wake up in the morning, if I walk down to the stop sign and back, I find myself coming back a little winded and in need of water, let alone walking for months. So I get it. I get it. I'm with Israel here. They need water and they don't have it. They need to drink. They're asking Moses, "Hey, where's the water?" But I think if we look closely, at least more closely, at their complaint, we're going to see that this is about a little bit more than water. In fact, this is about a lot more than water. Look at verses 3 through 5 with me again, as it states this. And the people quarreled with Moses and said, "Would that we had perished when our brothers perished before the Lord. Why have you brought the assembly of the Lord into this wilderness, that we should die here, both we and our cattle? And why have you made us come up out of Egypt to bring us to this evil place? It is no place for grain or figs or vines or pomegranates, and there is no water to drink. Dang. The nation of Israel is putting Moses on blast in this moment. You ever been there where one little thing just causes it all to kind of come out? You know, you ask me, hey, you know, how's it going? And then all of a sudden, we're getting a lot. That's what's happened here in this moment. Israel's been holding on to a lot of things. And here in this moment, they say, hey, Moses, there's no water, but I got a couple of things I want to share with you. And this is where the complaint of Israel begins to fall apart. I understand being in need of water. But as we look again at their complaint, specifically, they state in verse 4, why have you brought the assembly of the Lord into this wilderness that we should die here, we and our cattle? Verse 5, and why have you made us come up out of Egypt to bring us to this evil place? It's at this moment in our reading that if you followed along with the life and story of Israel, that your antenna should be up. And you should be real uncomfortable. Like, come again? What did you say? Egypt? Yeah, Egypt. It's insane to consider. It's insane for the nation of Israel to be standing here and say, you know what? I wish we would have been back in Egypt. Life's not going great now. Man, it was great in Egypt. Like, think about that for a moment. It's insane to consider. Why? Because when the nation of Israel was in Egypt, let's see the things that they had to do. They were enslaved. They had no freedom in food, no freedom in drink. They had to work endless hours. They were beaten, mistreated, taken advantage of. That's the Egypt that they're talking about in this moment. Why did you bring us to this terrible place in the middle of the wilderness that we would die? We have no hope. We have nothing. We wish we were back in Egypt. A place that was full of abuse, manipulation, and a nation that altogether did not care a moment if they would survive or if they were healthy. This is absurd. And there's even more evidence, actually, for the absurdity of this call in the beginning section that we read. When it talks about the nation of Israel going to the area of Zin in the wilderness of Kadesh, it says that Miriam died. Miriam, being a member of Moses' family, she was with the nation just 40 years previous in Exodus 17. We're not going to turn there, but in Exodus 17, it says, the whole Israelite community set out from the desert of Zin, traveling from place to place as the Lord had commanded. And they camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. So they quarreled with Moses and said, give us water to drink. Moses replied, why do you quarrel with me? Why do you put the Lord to the test? But the people were thirsty for water, and they grumbled against Moses. They said, why did you bring us up out of Egypt to make us and our children and our livestock die of thirst? Did you catch that? There it is again. Why did you bring us up out of Egypt? See, because when situations get difficult in the life of the nation of Israel, Egypt is their calling card. I don't like what's happening. Take me back to Egypt. We don't have the pomegranates that I thought we were supposed to. Take me back to Egypt. We've been walking for a really long time, and I'm tired, and I don't know where we're going. Take me back to Egypt. Egypt, Egypt, Egypt. When the nation doesn't know what to say, it doesn't know where to go, it doesn't know what's ahead of them, they've begun to believe that where they've been is better than where the Lord has them now. And so they grumble. They grumble, Egypt was so much better. Do you remember Egypt? Do you remember those long hours we worked where we were out there for days? Remember when we barely got the water that we needed? But man, Egypt must have been so much better. It's in this moment that we feel the temptation to pile on Israel and say, what are you doing? But we need to be fair to the nation of Israel. Why? Because we need to ask ourselves this question. What's our Egypt? Ask yourself that in this moment. What's my Egypt? What's that thing in my life? Who's that person? Where's that place that I yearn to go back to? This situation is too difficult for me. I wish I could go back to when I was in college. In this moment, they're asking too much of me. I wish I was still in that relationship or working at that job or in that living situation. What do we focus our grumbling on? And in so doing, create an alternate reality in which where we've been is so much better than where we are. Because in case you were wondering, the nation and land of Egypt wasn't the land of milk and honey that the grumbles of the nation may make you think it to be. In fact, Exodus chapter 1 tells us that the king of Egypt saw the nation of Israel as a threat. So this is how they were greeted when the king of Egypt took over. He said, so they put slave masters over them to oppress them with forced labor, worked them ruthlessly, made their lives bitter with harsh labor, with brick and mortar and all kinds of work in the fields. And in their harsh labor, the Egyptians worked them ruthlessly. That's the Egypt that the nation of Israel is saying, take me back. I got to go back. It's bound to be better. It's the cry they've had for 40 years. Take me back. And that might be a word for someone in the church this morning, that as absurd as we think the nation sounds for wanting to go back to that place and that time, is as absurd as you and I can sound in our lives when we yearn to go back to where we've been, believing that God's blessing, believing that God's provision, believing that God's care somehow existed in the past but does not come with us now into the present. The community grumbles. Now, Moses stands before the nation after hearing their complaint and has a decision to make. How will he respond to the complaints and grumbling of the community? Probably two choices. One, hey, they've been doing this for 40 years. If you can't beat them, join them. Start to grumble too. Or take an opportunity to fire back at them in the way that they've fired at you, and remind them of how absurd or unintelligent what they're saying may be. Praise God that Moses is in this situation and not Shane, because I probably would have taken one of those two, but thankfully a third perspective exists, and that's what we're going to look at in our second scene. We're calling this the leader humbles. Look with me, if you would, starting in verse 6, where it says, then Moses and Aaron went from the presence of the assembly to the entrance of the tent of meeting and fell on their faces. And the glory of the Lord appeared to them. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take the staff and assemble the congregation, you and Aaron and your brother, and tell the rock before their eyes to yield its water. So you shall bring water out of the rock for them and give drink to the congregation and their cattle. The leader humbles. And see, the leader humbles here in this moment because this isn't Moses' first time dealing with the nation. In fact, he's gotten, unfortunately, really used to the cries of a people who are lost and grumbling. And one of the things that continues to be true of Moses time and time again is that when he's faced with difficulty, he humbles himself before the Lord and says, what would you have me do? When he's faced with not knowing what the community and the congregation needs, he says, what would we do? Where would we go? How could you provide? And so Moses humbles himself here again in this moment and says, what will you have for us, God? How can I take care of these people? And see, Moses is not immune to the grumbles of the community. In fact, if there was anyone who had reason to grumble in the midst of the nation of Israel, it was Moses. Think about it. He was born into Egypt at a period of time when there was a decree that any male that was born was to be killed. Thankfully, instead of being killed, they were sent down the Nile River, and he and his life is saved, and he's raised up apart from his family, but in Pharaoh's house. And as he grows up, he finds himself and sees his people, the Israelites that he's a part of, being enslaved and being mistreated. And so he steps in and he stops the mistreatment of an Israelite, killing an Egyptian, only to be denied ownership from either the Egyptians or the Israelites, sent out into the wilderness. So 40 years into his life, he's almost been killed. He's been sent down a river. He's now nowhere with any family or anything to his name. Then God comes and speaks to him in a bush and says, go back, you're going to free my people. So Moses walks back in without confidence because he's got this a speech issue, but the Lord says he's with him. He goes and he's like, all right, hey, Pharaoh, we're going to head out. And he's like, nah. He's like, what? So then he has to go through this whole process where he's time and time and time again and plague after plague after plague, and he walks through this, and then finally Pharaoh, because God softens his heart, relents, and they get to walk through. And Moses is like, phew, I have been through a lot. This will be it. And he finds himself here at this river, at the sea, and he's like, oh no. We've gotten this far. They're coming. What do we do? And God says, I got you. opens the sea, they walk through. Moses is like, all right, this is bound to be, like, we're good now, right? No, they find themselves wandering for 40 years in the wilderness. All of this to say, Moses' complaint sheet could probably fill the room. Yet he's not the one with the community that stands there and grumbles and says, hey, where's my water at? No, he's the one who stands here in this moment, and he knows because he's seen time and time again, whether it be in Egypt, across the sea, wandering in the desert, that God always provides. And so he knows in this moment God is going to provide because he provided before. And if he did it before, he can do it again. So God always provides. So Moses comes before the Lord again and says, what should I do? What should I do? And God gives him clear instructions. See, because despite the complaints of the people, despite the fact that they have literally been given everything they need to eat, to drink, to survive, that they've been protected, that they've been guided, all of that, that their response is, I don't have what I need. God doesn't in turn say, well, you're about to not have anything. No, instead, he says, I will always provide. And so I'm going to provide now in this moment through Moses. All right. Looks like the people dodged a bullet there. They were grumbling. Thankfully, Moses, following what he's supposed to do, humbled himself. I can't wait to see how the end of this story goes. He's going to go to the rock. He's going to say, hey, water. It's going to come out. Everybody's going to be happy. We're going to be good. We're going to be able to go home. I know there's no football this week, but there's football next week. Awesome. Tie a ribbon on it. Let's look at our passage and see the fairy tale ending that I'm expecting, at least, when it comes to what we're reading. Starting in verse 9, and Moses took the staff from before the Lord as he commanded him to do. Verse 10, then Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly together before the rock, and he said to them, here's the moment. Here's the moment. God told him what to do. He humbled himself. Here we go. He's going to share with them. Okay, let's make sure we don't miss this. Verse 10, he said to them, hear now, you rebels. Shall we bring water for you out of this rock? And Moses lifted up his hand and struck the rock with his staff twice. And water came out abundantly. And the congregation drank and their livestock. Wait a second. That's not what Moses was supposed to do. That wasn't what Moses was supposed to do at all. The Lord had instructed him, hey, go before the people, bring them all together, and say to that rock, water will come forth, and it will come forth, and it will give them everything that they need. Maybe some got lost in translation. I don't know. I wasn't there. I mean, you know, a couple different languages being spoken. Maybe he just missed. Moses didn't do what he was instructed to do, yet water still came out of the rock and solved the thirst problem the nation had. Moses disobeyed the Lord, but the end result was that the people still got what they needed and had their thirst quenched. Moses didn't do what he's supposed to do in this moment. Yes, as a leader, he humbled himself, but as a mediator between God and man, he stumbled. In this third and final scene, the mediator stumbles. But water still came out. Okay, maybe Moses, probably an avid golfer, we don't know, fact checking, I don't know. Maybe this was Moses' mulligan. You know, he took a shot, God as the ultimate caddy said, I think this club, this, you know, you attack it with 100%, you'll be sitting right there at the green, took a shot and missed. But God said, hey, I got you, this is your mulligan, here we go. I mean, because as far as golfers are concerned, like Moses, this is like prime Tiger Woods. This is like red shirt on Sunday, U.S. Open. This is Nike commercial where the ball's like stop, logo, falls. Like Moses has played a great round of golf with the nation of Israel. Sure, he spent a little bit more time in the sand than any of us would care to deal with. But Moses has done a great job. So maybe this is the Lord just saying, I got you. You got a little ahead of your skis, but I'll take care of it. It has to be, right? Well, thankfully, our passage goes on, and I'm sure in this moment, God will say, hey, you know, Moses, it was a little rough. We still made it happen. Let's let bygones be bygones. Verse 12, and the Lord said to Moses and to Aaron, because you did not believe in me, to uphold me as holy in the eyes of the people of Israel. Therefore, you shall not bring this assembly into the land that I have given them. The mediator stumbles. Moses messed up. He should not have struck the rock. But here we are now. Why? Because the instructions that the Lord gave Moses were to speak to the rock. And speaking to the rock wasn't a minor detail. See, because God told him that if he spoke, water would come out. Yet he strikes and water comes out nevertheless. Why? Not because Moses has any ability, but because God has the ability. Why does water still come out of the rock? Why do the people get what they need? Because what we've been saying all along this morning, God always provides. God provides in the midst of a humble leader who comes before him and says, "What would you have me do?" In the same way, with the same amount of care and attention as he does when the mediator stands before him and stumbles. See, because God's provision in our life is not determined by our ability and our strength. God, praise the Lord for that. Moses was an awesome person. If we're looking in the Bible, you know, we're building our, you know, our starting five. He's in it. But he fell short. Praise the Lord that God's provision doesn't rely on Moses, just like God's provision doesn't rely on you. Why? Because God always provides. His people were thirsty, and he made sure they had something to drink. And as we look at the life of the nation of Israel, we can see that it's been God providing all along. It hasn't been Moses. See, the plagues in Egypt weren't Moses' idea. They were God's. And after the 10th plague, Pharaoh's heart was softened, not by Moses' cunning ability to negotiate. No, Moses had nothing to do with it. Pharaoh's heart was softened by the Lord, and they walked free. And when they got to the sea, it wasn't that they were able to walk across dry land because Moses had some knowledge of physics that if they went really fast or pushed the water back, they'd be able to get through. No, it was God who said, "I'll split the sea so you can walk right through it." And when they got to the wilderness and they didn't know where to go and they didn't know what was ahead of them, it wasn't Moses who lit a firework in the sky. No, it was God who brought a pillar of fire and said, "Follow me." And when their bellies started to grumble because they didn't have the food that they needed to survive, it wasn't Moses who said, "I'm going to go find us food in the middle of a desert where there's literally nothing." It was God who said, "Here's manna, collect it. Here's quail that you may eat." It's been God all along. Why? Because God always provides. Even in the face of grumbling, and even in the aftermath of stumbling, God always provides. And this is great news for you and for me. Because the nation of Israel isn't the only people who have ever grumbled, and Moses isn't the only one who's ever stumbled. No, we have grumbled. We have stumbled. And we, like the nation, are in a position where we cannot save ourselves. We, like the nation of Israel, are in a position where we have a great need, a need that's greater than water to drink because our lips are thirsty, a need for salvation, for renewal, for rebirth, to be made again, to be made right with God. And just like the nation, we can't do it on our own. And just like Moses, we can't do it on our own either. So what do we do? In the wandering, God provided through the rock despite disobedience. In our lives, God provides for us despite our disobedience as well. What you and I need in this moment, the provision that we're looking for and longing for, is a mediator. Now, you might be thinking to yourself, didn't we just establish that Moses was an insufficient mediator? We did. But thanks be to God, I don't think you and I are looking for a mediator in Moses. Thanks be to God that we can look forward, not from the time of the nation of Israel, but in through the rest of history to see that the mediator that you and I are looking for, he does not go by the name of Moses. In fact, he's not merely a man. But we're looking for a mediator who is the God-man, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our mediator, and there's a huge difference between he as our mediator and this mediator, Moses. Moses could not and proved that he would not and did not have the ability to perfectly live the instructions he'd been given. But the same cannot be said of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? The same cannot be said of our Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, throughout the New Testament, we see that Jesus is continuously referenced as this mediator who we can count on, as this person who we can go to, as this rock who is our salvation. 1 Corinthians says that Jesus is the spiritual rock that accompanied the nation, and he is Christ. Philippians 2 says that he, Jesus, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he, Jesus, made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, by being made in human likeness, and being found in the appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. Colossians says that he, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation, for by him all things were created, in heaven and earth, visible and invisible, and all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. That's our mediator. Moses was an imperfect mediator who sought assistance to bring forth water to the people of Israel. Jesus is the perfect mediator who says that he is the rock from which water will come and all can drink, but never be thirsty again. Jesus is the rock from which living water flows from freely. In the wilderness, the nation was thirsty, but as we walk through the wilderness of our life, our deep thirst cannot be quenched by water. Instead, it can only be quenched by the rock that is Jesus Christ. Jesus is our rock. And he is the one who will give us what we need. And as you and I experience the waters of salvation in our life that flow from the rock of Christ, we gain both the knowledge and the confidence that we can say, as we said at the beginning and we'll say now, that God always provides. God always provides. Whether it be water from a rock or salvation from a Savior, God always provides. We can join in the chorus of those who have come before us throughout the history of the church and say that God always provides. Now, there are three different responses that we have coming out of this passage this morning. First, if you're the believer in Jesus Christ who's here this morning, ask yourself this question. Am I allowing Jesus to be everything he's to be in my life? Am I allowing him to be that rock? Am I allowing him to be that mediator? Sure, maybe I did at the start when I first believed. Maybe I have before in different times. But as I've gone on, life's gotten tough. Situations have gotten hard. And this is just different than it used to be. Like the nation of Israel, I really am wishing I was back in that place or with that person or at that job. For you, I provide the encouragement, what our passage revealed to us this morning, that God always provides. So let him provide for you today as your mediator. Come and run and drink from the rock that is Christ. Second, for the person who's here this morning who's questioning, ask yourself this question. If you're here and doubting still that God can and will provide, allow the words of Paul in Romans to answer that question for you. For in Romans it states this, that he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? If God gave us Jesus as the author and perfecter of our faith, as the source of our salvation, how can we not state with confidence that God always provides? There will come seasons, there will be difficulty, there will be trials, but in the midst and in the face of everything, we can say that God always provides. It may not be easy, but it'll always be true. Finally, if you're here today and you're not too sure about Jesus, I first want to say thanks for being here. If you're questioning Christianity, you got a long list of, I don't know, how could it, maybe not this. We love questions. We love questions. I know that this church loves questions and is willing to interact and to listen. Let me add one question to that list for you. In what or in who are you trusting to absolutely provide everything you could ever need? Because if it's a relationship, it can come to an end. If it's a job, layoffs can occur and the stock market can crash. If it's in popularity, that comes and goes like the passing of the sun. Your upbringing, your family, your wealth can only take you so far. Avenue after avenue, identifier after identifier, whatever it is, everything has an end. And everything falls short. Our lives need something more. Our lives need someone more. And that person is Jesus. See, because Jesus won't fall short. Jesus won't fail. All other foundations will move, and any other source of water we will need to drink from again. But not Jesus. Not the rock of our salvation. Not the mediator of our soul. I encourage you to come and to drink from the rock. The rock that was pierced for our sins, and the rock that promises to provide for us everlasting life, a thirst that'll go away forever, and a life that can forever stand as a testimony that God always provides. Pray with me. Jesus, we come before you and we give thanks that you are the one, you are the rock. You are the one that we come to. You are the one who quenches our thirst forever. Father, forgive us for the times in our lives that we stand yearning to go back, believing as though your provision ended when we changed jobs, or that your grace was exhausted in a previous relationship. Father, forgive us for looking back and forgetting to give thanks for where you have us now and where you're bringing us in the future. God, thank you that despite our grumbling, in the midst of our stumbling, you still provide, because you love us and you're for us, not against us. We give you this praise, God, and we say that we as a people here desire to live our life on your foundation. And it's in the name of that foundation we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we respond.
Faithfulness, more.
sing that one more time. And great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Lord, unto me.
Let me read this text over you as our benediction, and then we'll leave. Lamentations chapter 3, 22 and 23. It reads this: the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. In the Hebrew text, it literally reads this: because of the steadfast love of the Lord, we are not cut off. Verse 23, for they are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Verse 24, the Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will trust and hope in him. I pray today was encouraging to your heart, your walk with Jesus. Remember, you are loved by the Father, united to the Son, and indwelt by the Holy Spirit. May God bless you and keep you. Have a fantastic week.